I'm Sebastian Monroe, president of the Republic and general of its militia.
My favorite bad guys are honest ones. I think bad guys are really useful to say uncomfortable truths to your heroes.
I know your dirty little secret. You just might sell out your friends.
The story of Monroe is an increasingly more tragic one. And he's a man that has been totally obsessed with and corrupted by power.
I tried to be nice.
They were fighting together in the part of the fight that Miles was least proud about.
That is who almost killed you. The others are his wife and kids.
Miles started to realize that maybe these people weren't trying to serve the greater good as he always thought he was. One continued on a path that the other one didn't agree with.
Don't you walk away from me!
Miles and Monroe come face to face, which is huge and emotional, and it's this tragic Cain and Abel story, and that's really the spine of these two brothers who deeply love each other and find themselves in a situation where inevitably they have to show down.
It was you and me, remember? It's always you and me.
They both genuinely wish that the other would join them. Monroe offers it.
You are nothing to me.
When you have a brother that you would think of as always someone you could trust and love, and you feel betrayed by that person, the anger that comes from that is very powerful.
Kill him.
For Monroe, who is still reeling about his loss, reeling about the fact that he's lost Rachel, he lost his opportunity with Miles. He had them all in his grasp, he had them all there, and he lost them. So he's starting to plummet into the depths of his anxieties.
I've been nothing but loyal, sir. I don't like you! I don't trust you.
He's having problems trying to figure out who he can trust and who he can't.
And he's finding himself much more increasingly isolated.
You want to know why Neville and Miles betrayed you? Because you were so paranoid that you pushed them away.
He's got a lot of vulnerability and pain that he's lashing out with.
Burn it all down.
World domination is generally not a good way to work through your anger issues. But we all have our methods.
He goes to such an extreme where he goes to his hometown and destroys all of those people that he grew up with.
Please, I want to see him again. Your son.
He's really galvanizing into this to find that boy, to find this piece of him that's out there somewhere.
And then we come to the tower. Something that represents everything for everyone.
For him to have power, it means death and destruction, and he needs to be stopped.
When Rachel and Monroe get together, there's always a few sparks.
You have always made excuses.
He's seen himself as the demonic, megalomaniacal dictator that he is, and it's soul-destroying.
You gotta believe me, I don't wanna let another one of your kids get hurt. I will help you.
We have another unexpected alliance, which has been kind of a recurring theme in the show. People who never thought they'd be fighting on the same side suddenly are.
That's another thing I'm interested to see in the following season is what's going to happen with the Monroe, Miles, Charlie situation, because they haven't worked things out, but I think faced with the situation, Charlie would kill Monroe.
I don't want to see him become good. What I'd like to see is to see him go off and find something. I don't know what he's looking for, but I don't think a man like that can be mended, but he can be useful.
I saw him a few weeks ago.
Who?
Monroe.
With Monroe, we find him brawling for a coin in a whorehouse. It's been a bit of a fall from grace for him. He has a lot of self-loathing. He always has. I mean, I think that he's now coming to terms with his former dictatorship.
Charlie's got a bit of a hard-on for Monroe. I don't know what the deal is. Look, he's been terrible to her family, don't get me wrong, but she's really taken everything pretty personally, and she wants blood.
Invariably, sparks will fly.
Rise and shine.
What I think is interesting about Monroe and Charlie in this episode is Charlie finds herself face to face with the man that the Mathesons hold responsible for the death of her brother and her father. So to lock them up in an abandoned swimming pool, of all places, those were some of the most fun scenes to write.
She's like a caged lion in that moment, being beside the person that you've sworn you're going to kill and your biggest enemy, and you're right beside him, and there's nothing that you can do about it.
We're both roped to one place, and so we only have the war of wits to go by.
Did it ever occur to you you sucked at your job?
She says some pretty telling truths to him.
And he just knows what to say just to piss her off.
You might be trying to run away from your mom, but you are a hell of a lot like her.
The brawl. Yeah, I've had fun.
She hits hard.
He was like, don't worry about it, don't worry about it. It doesn't really hurt, it's fine. Okay.
Charles, stop.
So I kept hitting him, and it was fun for me.
He's destroyed a massive part of her family, her father and her brother. And he's more than aware that he has some penance to pay. And I'm not sure how he's going to pay it, but I'm sure that Eric's cooking up something.
Monroe is a character that's going to keep us guessing until the end. His motivation's never totally clear. And even when he's cards up with something, as he is in this episode, telling Charlie, I've got a lot to make up for, she's not buying it.
Can you make your eyes water like that at will?
He's blinded by this sense of trying to fix the situation. He doesn't know how to. How does one pay the penance of such atrocity? And he himself doesn't feel that he's redeemable in any way, but he's certainly trying.
My favorite scene in this episode is a scene with no dialogue, and it's really only a few seconds long. You see Monroe and Charlie on the back of that wagon, and they're heading to Willoughby. It's the kind of team-up that should really hit you, because they're alone, and they're close, and they're heading to the same place, which is just about the last thing you would expect from that pair after seeing them in 202 locked in the pool, and seeing them in countless season one episodes just at each other's throats. In this moment, we go off with them united, knowing that when they get to Willoughby, that'll set off a whole new series of bombs. It's gonna be a recipe for some pretty exciting things.
Okay, so now you need to promise me to not explode or go crazy.
That's never a good...
I think Charlie feels a sense of guilt, almost like she's betraying Miles and, you know, leading him into the lion's den a little bit. And, but really just hoping that she's doing the right thing and trying to trust that he'll also agree with her.
You brought him here. You don't need to give everything all at once. There's going to be plenty of time now that these two characters are back together to build upon all that history and all that, all the dynamic that we're used to seeing, but you have to start someplace.
They nuked our city, Miles!
When Monroe meets Miles for that first time, I think that he has enough semblance of self and reason to explain to Miles that together we can do this. Divided, we're gonna be conquered.
I'm asking for a truce.
It's a lot easier to tether a character to something that's a lot more meaningful, like redemption, love, family, all of those things that we yearn for and that he's lost.
When Monroe comes around and I realize that, yeah, good or bad, he can be helpful. I gotta take that route. Yeah, we did some horrible things and there was some horrible ideas back then, but damn, we did a good job together. But of course, Monroe with his mania and his pathos, he's going to try to do some things his own way that are not necessarily going to be agreeable.
All we got to do now is frame the Patriots for this.
Fortunately, because of that pathos, it tends to work out pretty well.
In this episode, episode 6, Monroe finally is faced with all of his crimes and pays the ultimate price.
I hereby sentence you to die by lethal injection.
I think the man's been running around with a death wish for a while. Having that granted, though, is a very, very different thing. All roads lead to this, and he kind of knew it was coming. Doesn't make it easy.
Monroe's flashbacks in this episode are like an emotional travelogue of his journey from man to monster. I mean, you really get a chance to see the destruction of Monroe.
And it's that same really simple through line that has been tugging at Monroe the whole season, last season, which is family. And what is the etymology of that? And it's a man that has lost his parents and his sisters, and then found something, and in that person, you know, had the beauty of childbirth, almost. Not only loses his child, but loses his wife.
They're both gone.
It's heartbreaking, but it's illuminating, because he isn't just a war criminal. And he isn't just a disaffected ex-soldier. He's a lot of things, but he's a man. And when you see those flashbacks and you see what he's become, it helps add a shading to the character that enhances the tragedy of what occurs here.
Who asked you to kill anybody?
Who asked for anything, Miles? Bad things that just happen.
You get to see the initial seed of sin that he swallows and then just goes nuts. That's Kripke.
The Monroe Republic and Sebastian Monroe, while useful as a villain, David, sort of to his credit, made that character so sympathetic and wounded, but you kind of understand him and you kind of want to like get to know him a little bit, and which is one of the reasons that he's joining our group as a very untrustworthy protagonist, because he's just as shady and sketchy as he was last year, but now he's lost everything. And being sentenced to die really causes you to reflect on all those things. And so he reaches out to Miles and just asks Miles for this just very simple final request, which is acknowledge our friendship.
We had some good times, didn't we?
Yeah, we did.
It's two guys that don't deal with emotions very well, saying all they need to say in a very, very simple line, which is great. And then in that moment of vulnerability, Monroe needs to tell his best friend, his only, the only guy that he's got, I got a son, look after him.
Your son is fine.
You get to this juicy moment just as we've gone from foe back to friend. Boom, here comes the bomb. So you get to leave that scene in a much more fraught place than you began.
How can you do that to me?
For Miles to be carrying around a secret like this for all these years and keeping it from Monroe, it's been eating away at him in a way that we never knew and were never able to see. It adds to the heartbreak that that's their final beat before Monroe is marched to the courthouse. I would go so far as to say this is the hardest goodbye Miles has ever had to say. This is his brother. This is his best friend. It's clear that the loss of Monroe absolutely destroys Miles for reasons he can't even verbalize.
And I love that scene because it's, I think it really shows where Charlie and Miles have come to. Before, she would have kind of been pressing him for answers. How are you doing? You want to talk about it sort of thing. And they know each other so well now. She just needs to let him know that she's there for him, and then knows that he needs to be on his own, understands that. And they know each other's boundaries and are so, so much more in tune now than ever before.
I'm around, Kate. Don't try to move.
207 was a fun scene to shoot because there's an unapologetic aspect to being high on drugs where you can play an aspect of character which will never be ever seen again unless someone spikes his beer.
David played it so brilliantly, but he was so freaking cute when he was waking up that me and Elizabeth were just dying behind the screen.
I'm sitting there watching and my character's supposed to hate him, and you can see me in the background almost kind of like smile a little. I mean, Rachel hates him, but he's not really like the Monroe we've grown to hate. And, you know, I've always had a hard time with the fact that he killed her son because he didn't actually try to just kill her son. So every time I say it, I'm always like, you know, he was really just trying to kill all of us. See, it's much better.
Hey, buddy.
David just looked like a little angel, and it made the whole thing so odd and weird, and we all walked off set, and we're all like, we like Druggy Monroe. Like, that is like our thing. Because he's instantly neutralized. He just turned into a really sweet guy.
You're happy to see me.
What?
You miss me. You're my best friend.
We had a lot of fun letting the guards down a little bit in terms of character and in terms of the warmth within this incredibly dysfunctional family.
We had to walk away when he says this line of, where are you guys going? But after we've already left the room. And all of us, even camera, everybody was all just cracking up laughing that day. So that was really fun.
I'm mortified because there was some ridiculous takes in there. So we'll see how they edit it together. Let's hope they protect me in some way.
If you don't help me, I will never help you find your kid.
It's clear in this moment that these two men will stop at nothing to get their goal. And talk about things that are worth dying for. Monroe will find that boy.
So for the second half of the season is very much, for Monroe, his quest to be reunited with his kid. And it's going to take a few of them on a journey.